الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran regarding Ramadan, he says in Surah Al-Baqarah, he says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. He says that you who believe, fasting has been prescribed for you the way it was prescribed for people in the past before you, so that you might become conscious of Allah, or you might become mindful or fearful of Allah. When we look at these verses, it's really important for us to kind of break it down. First of all, Allah is saying, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, speaking to people who already believe. And he's basically saying, all of you who claim to believe, all of you who claim to be Muslims, you need to listen up carefully because I'm about to give you some guidance, some instructions, either telling you to do something or telling you to stay away from something. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always says whenever he speaks to the believers in the Quran. It says, Kutiba alaykum as-siyam. Fasting has been prescribed for you. And the word kutiba is from kataba, means to write. It's almost like writing a prescription. When you go to a doctor and you're like, oh, my shoulder hurts, or my face is hurting, or my foot is hurting, or something like that, I'm not feeling well. What do? When they inspect you, they analyze you, and they say, let me look at what's wrong with you. Let me look at what you actually need to get better, to get healthier. And then they write a prescription, and you're supposed to follow that prescription. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looking at every single believer, at every single Muslim, and saying, hey, you need this in your life. You need Ramadan. You need to start fasting, and you need to make sure that this fasting in the month of Ramadan is going to be done so that you can get closer to Allah. And then he says, كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. The way it was prescribed for people in the past. I mean, you're not the first community that's ever fasted. You're not the first people who ever had been prescribed fasting. It's worked for them in the past, the people who followed it properly, who had the right intention, who did it the right way. So it's been done before. People, this is not something brand new. It's like not like anyone, no one has ever heard of fasting before the Quran was revealed. People were aware of the concept of fasting. And it makes sense. The idea in and of itself, it makes sense, because when you're refraining from something that you're normally allowed to do, what are you doing? You're doing something to improve yourself. You're doing something to kind of push yourself to the limit to gain some kind of benefit. And we're going to look at what the benefit is. What is the benefit at the end? He says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you might perhaps become mindful and conscious of Allah, or fearful of Allah. You might become aware. Now, this word تَتَّقُونَ from taqwa. Taqwa means to be aware of Allah, and that awareness actually creates a sense of responsibility in you. So if you were told to walk along a land, and you were told, hey, this is a minefield. Everywhere there's a mark, there's a landmine there. If you step on it, you're going to blow up. How would you walk? You would walk very cautiously, right? Every step you'd be like, I'm going to make absolute sure that I'm not stepping on a landmine, because it's going to be a huge problem. When that's taqwa, that means you're alert, you're aware, you're mindful, you're conscious, you're constantly thinking, what am I supposed to be doing that Allah wants me to do, and what am I going to avoid that Allah does not want me to ever do because it's bad for me. So it says basically, when you fast in Ramadan, you're going to be able to gain more taqwa in your life. Now, how does that work? It's not a difficult procedure to understand. When we think about it, we try to understand what fasting does and how it builds taqwa. Well, when you're fasting, what are you doing? You're giving up three things. You're giving up food, you're giving up drink, and you're giving up intimacy, or intercourse in particular. You're giving up, and it's interesting. You know, whenever I talk to non-Muslims, I say, we're not eating, and then we're not drinking. The first thing they always ask is, yeah, but you can drink, right? I say, no, you can't drink anything. But you can drink water, right? No, you can't drink water either. And it just boggles their mind. They're like, that's insane. And I was just recently talking to someone, they're Catholic. And they're like, you can't even drink water? I'm like, no. But when we fast, and it's Lent, we fast too. Like we give up meat or we give up something, we give up coffee or something like that. They can't fathom that you're giving up water as well, right? We're not going to die. I'm just giving it up for like, you know, 16 hours or 15 hours or something along those lines. But that's where the self-discipline comes in. Now, you're giving up food, you're giving up drink, you're giving up intimacy. These are the three fundamental desires, core desires that human beings have built into them. So what happens is, and they're halal normally. If you eat the halal food, you get a halal drink, and you get married, you're allowed a halal relationship. You're allowed these three things. They're allowed for you. They're halal. But in Ramadan, when you're fasting, they become haram for you for a temporary period of time. Why do you make something haram for you when it's technically halal for you? So that you develop self-control. You develop self-discipline. How does it work? It's not difficult to understand. Is that if you are tempted outside of Ramadan when you're not fasting or at any time in your life, you're tempted to drink alcohol. And you're like, I really want to drink some of that. And you're like, wait a minute. I gave up water while I was fasting. Giving up water is harder than giving up alcohol, right? Unless you're an addict or something like that. Just generally, your ability to try. Refraining from this, you as a more natural craving to water, to hydrate yourself, to just quench your thirst when it's hot and it's summer season or something like that. All of that is built in. If you had the willpower to resist that, and that's what you're building up, you're building that resistance up. You're getting used to it. If you could do that, you can give up that drink. So, you know, I always wondered what beer tasted like. I always wanted to try a sip of wine. You know, that temptation comes to some Muslims as well. Like, I wonder, you know, what it's like or something like that. And you're like, you know what? Why would I do that? Forget that. It's nonsense, right? I gave up water. I gave that up for Allah. So I can give this up for Allah. That's taqwa. Same thing. I always wanted to try that pepperoni, that pork or something like that. I gave up food, all food. I was hungry. My stomach was growling, was grumbling. It was like telling me, you know, feed me something. Like I need some food. And I gave that up. I can give up all of these other haram things. Whether it's marijuana, whether it's pork, whether it's, you know, any other type of thing that I'm not allowed to eat. And I know Allah does not want me to eat. I can give it up. So there's automatically that building up of self-discipline. That building self-discipline and building that self-control that Allah wants us to have. That's what Ramadan is about. That's what fasting is about in particular. Now, Ramadan is about the Quran. And the other verse which reminds us about the whole context needs to be understood really well. Because sometimes we put so much emphasis on fasting and just food and we forget that the purpose of Ramadan is connected to the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another verse, He says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنُ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ. He says the month of Ramadan in which the Quran was revealed is a guidance for all humanity. It's a guidance for all people. So basically Allah is saying in the month of Ramadan, the Quran was revealed, right? 1400 years ago, the Quran was revealed to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. And it continued to be revealed over a period of 23 years. And that is the book that we recite today. What about it? Saying it is a guidance for all people. So the Quran is a guidebook. So what is so special about Ramadan? The book that everyone should be living their life according to was revealed in this month. So we're commemorating the Quran in the month of Ramadan. It's not just about fasting. We're commemorating the Quran because everyone commemorates what they consider to be a significant event and they consider to be an important thing in their life. So the 4th of July is a commemoration in America. People do fireworks and they sing anthems and all of that stuff. They get together, mostly just to party, but there's still a significance because they say the American independence from England is an extremely important event and we must remember it. So we have to commemorate it because it has value and we want to make sure people understand its value. Cinco de Mayo is another festival. You have other festivals, people celebrate Christmas, assuming it, you know, wrongly to be the birth of Jesus. You know, you have other celebrations all over the place. People commemorate events that they consider to be valuable. What are Muslims commemorating? Islam is telling us commemorate the Quran because it is a book of guidance. And having a book of guidance in your life is one of the most important and valuable things you can ever have. One of the best things you could possibly have in your life. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى. The second part of it, next it says, and there are clear signs of guidance in the book. Meaning if someone reads the Quran and they try to understand it and with an open mind, removing their prejudices, what's going to happen? They're going to understand that this book is really from Allah. So the signs are clear that this book is a true book. It's really coming from God. It's really a true revelation. And then, wal furqan. So three functions. The Quran is a book of guidance. It has clear signs of guidance in it for people who are don't have prejudice and they can read it with the open mind. And number three, it is a furqan. It is a criterion which will help you distinguish between what is good and what is evil, what is good and bad. And this is something that we need in our lives, right? People are confused about everything today. They're confused about their gender. Like, is there just male and female, or people can turn into different genders? They're confused about their sexuality. They're confused about, you know, are men and women supposed to be mating, or is it okay if men and men are having, being intimate with each other and having intercourse with each other, and women? People are confused about zoophilia, right? Bestiality. People are having relationships with animals. It's disgusting, but it happens. We're talking millions of people. There's like a whole animal sex tourism industry. I hate to even mention this, you know, in such a blessed time, but this is the reality. People are confused about so many things, about, you know, whether doing drugs, whether smoking weed, whether, you know, smoking crack, maybe LSD, ecstasy, all of those things, whether they're good for society, bad for society. Should there be freedom? Should we legalize it? Should we decriminalize it, even if we're not going to use it? All of this confusion is there in the minds of people. And Islam is telling us that this book, The Quran is saying it. This book is the Quran, it is the Furqan. It will tell you what is right and wrong. It does tell you what is good for society, what is bad for society. What is good for the individual, what is bad for the individual. So we need this book in our lives. Everyone needs the Quran in their life, especially during times of confusion. So we commemorate in the month of Ramadan. And we say, Alhamdulillah, praise belongs to Allah. We thank Allah for giving us this opportunity to be able to connect with the Quran, to be able to remember the Quran, because the fact that we have it in our life prevents us from doing so many ridiculous things that if we didn't have the guidance of Islam in our lives, we may be doing some really horrible things. And alhamdulillah, it prevents us from so many things. Prevents us from gambling, prevents us from drinking, prevents us from suicidal, you know, tendencies and following up on them. All sorts of these things. Alhamdulillah, Islam is a huge blessing. Then Allah says at the end, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ. So whoever witnesses the month, if you live till the month of Ramadan and you're in the month of Ramadan, you need to fast, right? And that's where the whole fasting comes back. What does fasting do? It builds that self-discipline. It builds that self-control. And what it's going to end up doing is going to get you to a level where you start becoming more aware of what your purpose in life is, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is listening and watching every single thing that you do. And now you start to change your behavior, because that's the way human beings are naturally. Human beings naturally, if they're like, if they think they're alone by themselves and they have some thoughts and they're like, oh, I'm going to go on my computer, I'm going to go on this website or something like that. And then all of a sudden, if they look up and they're like, oh no, the government put a security camera, you know, in my house or something like that. Or you're sitting in the library and you look up, you see like a camera, you're like, oh, someone's watching me. Now all of a sudden you're like, oh no, I'm not going to do something. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching us all the time. And we just, sometimes we want to ignore it. Sometimes we want to pretend like He's not watching or something. We would be embarrassed if your parents walked in and they saw you on a website that you're not supposed to be on, or your grandparent or your spouse, you know, saw what window you left open or something like that. Just think about that, you know, the type of music you're listening to, the type of movie that you're watching, whatever it may be, something you're embarrassed about. If we're embarrassed in front of human beings, shouldn't we be as embarrassed in front of Allah? That is taqwa. That is the purpose of our fasting. That is the purpose of Ramadan and connecting us with the Quran, so that we can actually live our lives by a guidance, a code of morals. In an age of moral relativism, where people can't figure out what is right and wrong, that is what's best for the individual, and that is best what's best for humanity. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our fasting. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to understand the Quran at a very deep level and to implement it in all aspects of our life. Ameen. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nastaghfirukallah wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
صلِّ وسلِّم دائماً أبداً على